Very good morning. Today, let us learn about tocolytics. Tocolytics, the preterm labor and delivery can be delayed by drugs in order to improve the prenatal outcome and thus reduce perinatal mortality and morbidity significantly. So uterine relaxants, that is tocolysic, indomethacins, that is NSAID, nifedipine, that is calcium channel blockers, magnesium sulfate, and terbutalin, that is adrenergic agonist. Earlier, the time tested, we have used duodilan, that is isoxaprin hydrochloride, comes with a marketing name, duodilan, widely used for almost quite a few years, and then that has totally replaced with the drugs which I am going to discuss now. The reason for replacement of these present drugs is because of the side effects existing with isoxaprin hydrochloride. So that we used it orally and intravenous injection as in chronic tocolysis and acute tocolysis. Whereas concept of chronic tocolysis, that is long-term uterine relaxant property, is almost abolished. There's only a question of acute tocolysis where you want the steroid to act within probably 24 to 48 hours. Till that time, you don't want the parturient to set in labor. So that is the idea where you are trying to give acute tocolysis prior to steroid injections. So classification of tocolytics, that is beta 2 adrenergic receptor agonist, terbutalin, ritodrine, isoxaprin, and magnesium sulfate. Calcium channel blockers, nifedipine, nicardipine, oxytocin receptor antagonist, atosiban, which is being widely marketed nowadays. Prostaglandin synthetase inhibitors, that is indomethacin, aspirin, ibuprofen, sulindac. Nitric oxide donors, that is nitroglycerin and halothane. Okay. Mechanism of action of tocolytic drugs. So how does it act? Some drugs acts on nitric oxide donors, which reduces the contractility and in turn the myosin like chain kinase coupling is reduced and muscle contractility is reduced. That's one way. The other beta mimetic drugs, that which acts on a beta adrenergic receptors, then in turn G protein, which will in turn act on a cyclic AMP, again the same myosin light chain kinase. The COX inhibitors, like which acts on prostaglandin receptors, then which in turn acts on inositol phosphate. The other receptors are oxytocin receptor antagonists. Then the calcium channel blockers, which mainly magnesium, which acts on calcium channel blockers. The magnesium sulfate is also being used, mainly being used for eclampsia, and the other uses are as a tocolysis, and which has got a hygroscopic action. Even we can use it in where there is a vulval edema following a severe preeclampsia or eclampsia. To drain it out, we used to give a crystals. So these are the other uses. Even though magnesium sulfate is not a antihypertensive, anticonvulsant, and it's being widely used as an antihypertensive, anticonvulsants, and tocolysis. So this is a wonder drug, very cost effective, and side effects are very minimal, but those levels in the magnesium levels in the serum has to be monitored. and look for toxicity. Okay, coming to calcium channel blockers. Yeah. So nifedipine, nicardipine and verapamil. Nifedipine acts, mechanism of action is blocks the entry of calcium inside the cell. Doses is oral is 10 to 20 mg every 3 to 6 hours. The side effects and the precautions are maternal hypertension, headache, flushing, nausea. The combined therapy with beta mimetic or magnesium sulfate should be avoided, because both acts on a calcium channel blockers, which has got a side effect of hypotension, synergistically then this action will be increased. Second is the magnesium sulfate, as we already discussed, which acts on competitive inhibition of calcium ion either at the motor end place at the cell membrane, reducing calcium influx. Less acetylcholine release and its sensitivity at motor end plate and direct depressant action on uterine muscle. The dosages, loading dose 4 to 6 grams IV over 20 to 30 minutes followed by an infusion of 1 to 2 grams per hour. The continuous tocolysis for 12 hours after the contractions have stopped. Tocolytic effect is very poor. Side effects and the precautions, it is relatively safe. The common maternal side effects are flushing, perspiration, headache, muscle weakness, and rarely a pulmonary edema. And the neonatal side effects are lethargy, hypotonia, and rarely respiratory depression. Contraindication is patients with myasthenia gravis and impaired renal function. And coming to the indomethacin. Indomethacin is a cyclooxygenase inhibitor. Sulindac is the another NSAID, is also used as it has less placental transfer. Mechanism of action is it reduces the synthesis of prostaglandins, thereby reducing the intracellular calcium levels, which in turn activation of the muscle contraction couplings and reduces the uterine contraction. The dosage is loading dose 50 mg per hour per orally or per rectally also we can give, followed by 25 mg every 6 hours for 48 hours. Side effects and precautions. Maternal, heartburn, asthma, GI bleeding, thrombocytopenia and renal injury. Contraindications are hepatic disease, active peptic ulcer, coagulation disorders. The fetal and neonatal side effects is constriction of the ducts, arteriosus, oligohydramnios, and neonatal pulmonary hypertension and IUGR. Beta mimetics, example terbutalin, ritodrine, and as I was telling, isoxaprilin, which was earlier very much in vogue and effective for 48 hours. Allow time for steroids and antibiotics to work. The mechanism of action is activation of intracellular enzymes, that is adenylate cyclase, cyclic AMP, protein kinase, reduces the intracellular free calcium, that is reduction of the calcium, and inhibits activation of the contraction couplings, which in turn reduce interaction of actin myosin and the smooth muscle relaxation. Dosages, ritodrine is given IV infusion, 50 microgram per minute is increased by 50 microgram every 10 minutes until contraction cease. Infusion is continued after about 12 hours after the contraction gets over. Terbutalin, which has got a longer half-life compared to a ritodrine, which has and fewer side effects, it can be given as a subcutaneous injection of 0.25 milligrams. Every 3 to 4 hours is given. Even the terbutalin can be given when there is a following oxytocin or misoprostol induced tachycystole or hyperstimulation, where you want the uterus to be absolutely, you know, come into a relaxation position. That is the time we give terbutalin as a tocolytic also. So it acts quickly. The side effects are maternal headache, palpitation, tachycardia, pulmonary edema, hypertension, cardiac failure, ARDS, lactic acidemia, and even death. The fetal side effects are tachycardia, heart failure, IUFD, neonatal or hypoglycemia, and interventricular hemorrhage. And the last but not the least is the oxytocin antagonists. Example, atosiban, which acts on blocking the myometrial oxytocin receptors. It inhibits the intracellular calcium release, which releases the prostaglandins and thereby inhibits the myometrial contractions. Doses is IV infusion, which is given 300 microgram per minute. Initial bolus may be needed. The side effects are nausea, vomiting, and chest pain, very rarely. The dose is very important here. We should give it IV infusion, 300 microgram per minute, and the initial bolus may be needed. But the problem with the atosiban is the availability and the cost. And nitric oxide donors, that is glycerol trinitrate. It is a smooth muscle relaxant, which is available in terms of patches, may cause a cervical ripening and headache. So generally, we apply patches over the fundus of the uterus as a tocolytic and wait till 8 to 10 hours, and then if required, the patch has to be reapplied. The sites of action of tocolytic drugs in the uterine myometrium is a beta-2 agonist, which act on cyclic AMP, NO donors, which acts on cyclic GMP, and the contraction coupling is reduced, calcium influx is reduced, so that there won't be any contraction of the muscle. Labor is the only blind date where you will meet the love of your life. Thank you.